Matthew chapter 12, verse 38 to 42. Matthew 12, verse 38 to 42. And also 2 Chronicles chapter 9, verse 1 to 4. We will read first Matthew 12, verse 38 to 42. Then we're going to turn, go back to the Old Testament, 2 Chronicles chapter 9, verse 1 to 4. So we start with Matthew 12, verse 38 to 42. The Bible says, "Then some of the scribes and Pharisees answered, saying, 'Teacher, we want to see a sign from you.' But he answered and said to them, 'An evil and adulterous generation seeks after a sign. No sign will be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh will rise up in the judgment with this generation and condemn it, because they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and indeed a greater than Jonah is here. The Queen of the South will rise up in the judgment with this generation and condemn it, for she came from the ends of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon, and indeed a greater than Solomon is here.'" 2 Chronicles chapter 9, verse 1 to 4. 2 Chronicles 9, verse 1 to 4. "Now when the Queen of Sheba heard of the fame of Solomon, she came to Jerusalem to test Solomon with hard questions, having a very great retinue, camels that bore spices, gold in abundance, and precious stones. When she came to Solomon, she spoke with him about all that was in her heart. So Solomon answered all her questions. There was nothing so difficult for Solomon that he could not explain it to her. When the Queen of Sheba had seen the wisdom of Solomon, the house that he had built, the food on his table, the sitting of his servants, the service of his waiters and their apparel, his cupbearers and their apparel, and his entryway by which he went up to the house of the Lord, there was no more spirit in her." The topic, the title of the message is Solomon, the picture of Jesus. Solomon pictures Jesus. Today, I want to look at a comparison of Solomon and Jesus. Now, in the New Testament, they came to Jesus asking, "What sign shall you give us that we may believe?" People are looking for a sign to believe. People are looking for a reason to be a Christian, to be into a relationship with God. They were asking for a sign. "What sign shall you give us that you may believe that you are the Son of God?" And Jesus said, even as he had said earlier, if you remember, when he started his ministry, he wiped or he cleaned the temple. And when he did that, the chief priest asked Jesus, "What sign are you going to give us to believe you are the Son of God or you are the God?" And he said, "Destroy this body, and on that day, I'm going to lift it up again." So Jesus has only given a singular sign. There is only one sign to prove that he's the only way to the Father. He is God. He is better than Buddha or Confucius or Krishna or Muhammad or any politician. The only sign he gave is a sign of death and resurrection. That's what he said there in John chapter 2, verse 18 and 19. "Destroy this temple, and on the third day, I'm going to raise it again." And he was talking of his death. And even here, in Matthew 12, our reading today, when they asked for a sign, Jesus said, "This adulterous, is asking and requesting for a sign, and no sign shall be given to it but the sign of Jonah." And he said, even as Jonah was in the belly of the fish for 3 days and three nights, so the Son of Man shall be in the tomb or in the earth for 3 days and three nights. For your information, between this was not part of my message. That in a way challenges our Good Friday. You know, we celebrate Jesus that he died on the Good Friday. That's a message for another day. But if you calculate, if he died on Friday, then we don't have 3 days and three nights. We only have 3 days, but we have two nights. We only have Friday night and Saturday night. So if I was to go with what Jesus said, then Jesus was crucified. Okay, this is a hard lesson now. Was crucified on Thursday. And I can prove from the scriptures. There is a man on the Last Supper, there is a man who is carrying pitcher. You know, he's carrying water, a bucket. In those days, men were not carrying water. It's women who used to fetch water. So that man must have been a zealot. Zealots didn't have wives, and they were living in the desert. Now the zealots, okay, I'm getting to a totally different message. We will come to that when we come to Easter and Good Friday. But the point is, Jesus said he will be in the tomb, he will be in the earth for 3 days and three nights. He'll be in the tomb for 3 days and three nights. That's a sign that he gave, the sign of resurrection. The reason why Jesus is Lord and Jesus is God is that he died and he rose again. All the other gurus or political leaders or religious leaders, they died, but none can claim that he resurrected. Then he continues and he says that, like the Queen of Sheba, the way she went to Solomon with hard questions, where we read in 2 Chronicles chapter 9, she received all the answers that she melted. She had no spirit in her. And Jesus said, greater than Solomon is here. I want to show you that Jesus is greater than Solomon. And Jesus said, the Queen of Sheba shall arise and address this generation. Because she believed in the wisdom of Solomon, she took a long journey to go listen to Solomon, and a greater than Solomon, Jesus Christ, is here. Now, first and foremost, that one contradicts or beats the doctrine of reincarnation. What Krishna teach us and the Hindus, when they say that if you are a good person, you die, you shall come back like a nice good animal. You shall come back better if you are a good person in this world. But if you are an evil, bad person, then you shall come back like a bad animal. But the Bible teaches there is no reincarnation. We are told here that the Queen of Sheba, who lived 1,000 years before Christ, she will appear not as a cat, not as a dove, not as an elephant or a lion. She will appear as the Queen of Sheba. So there is nothing, there is no doctrine of reincarnation. You will appear, and not just appear, you will be known the way you are. For example, when Jesus was at the mountain of Transfiguration, and Moses and Elijah appeared, they didn't appear like different people. They didn't appear like other people. They appeared like Moses and Elijah. Interestingly, they didn't have name tags. Yet, Moses lived 1,500 years ago, but Peter identified him. No name tag, no introduction, but when Peter saw them, he identified, this is Moses and this is Elijah. So when we get to heaven, we will identify one another. We will know one another. And that one proves that you are who you are now, and you will appear in the other world. And then the Bible says that, continue to say that now in our second reading, she, the Queen of Sheba, she left her country. Now we don't know exactly where Sheba is. There are two notions of Sheba. One, some people say it's Arabia. Others say it is Ethiopia. We are not certain. Okay, but we know that recently there are some Ethiopian Jews. These are Jews who left recently, they've left their country and they are going back to Israel claiming they are Jews and they belong to that country. So we know they are Ethiopian Jews. These are people for all these years, though they are in Ethiopia, they follow the traditions and the ways of Judaism. Some people say, it's not in the Bible, but some people say historically that when Queen of Sheba went to see Solomon, she left pregnant with Solomon's baby. And so those are the Ethiopian Jews in Ethiopia today. There are people who carry that notion. But the point is that whether Ethiopia or Saudi Arabia, let's take Saudi Arabia, which is close to Israel. The distance between Saudi Arabia to Israel, it's a distance. If you are to travel with camels, it's a distance that will take you 75 days, you know, like over 2 months to arrive there. But this woman, after she heard the wisdom of Solomon, she left with these camels and she traveled all these miles, bumpy and stinky journey, to go and listen to the wisdom of Solomon. Yet Jesus is saying in Matthew 12, our reading today, Jesus, there is one that is greater than Solomon. Praise the Lord. I mean, a woman travels for 75 days to go listen to the wisdom of a human being. Yet at times we feel it's too much when we are being invited to church, when we are being invited to a fellowship. She didn't just cover the journey, the trip, but also we are told she carried lots of wealth, lots of retinue, lots of riches to go give as gifts to Solomon. But I'm here to announce there is a greater than Solomon, and that is Jesus Christ. We need to give him our time. We need to give him our resources. We need to give him our attention. Whatever it takes for us to fellowship with the Lord, let us take the journey. When she arrived, she was amazed. At the end of the story, she says that half was not told. I heard a lot about Solomon, but half was not told. What did she see? What did she see with Solomon? And why is it that Jesus is greater than Solomon? I want to share with us a number of things we can see here, 7 of them, that this Queen of Sheba interacted with Solomon. And Jesus is greater than this Solomon. Solomon is great. I mean, he's a rich man, very, very rich. He was so rich that the Bible says that during his reign, he had made silver to be valueless. Bible says that silver was like stones in the ruling or in the reign of King Solomon. Not just rich, but also he was very sharp intellectually. His intellectual ability was very high. Why? Because this is a man who wrote over 3,000 proverbs and sang 1,005 songs. Solomon, over 3,000 proverbs, 1,005 songs by Solomon. He was also very romantic. 700 wives, 300 concubines. I mean, that is Solomon. But then, there is greater than Solomon, and his name is Jesus. Now, number one, comparing Solomon Solomon and Jesus, number one, Solomon had wisdom. Solomon had wisdom. We all remember how God appeared to Solomon in a dream when he started his reign and said to Solomon, ask whatever you want. And he said, give me wisdom that I may know how to go out and how to come in. You've made me a great leader of this great nation. And God said to Solomon, because you didn't ask victory over your enemies, and because you didn't ask for riches, I'm going to give you wisdom. And with wisdom, I will defeat your enemies, and I'm going to make you very prosperous. Solomon, the wisest man, a man full of wisdom. We all know that. But Jesus is not full of wisdom. Jesus is wisdom himself. Bible says in Colossians 2 and verse 3, Colossians chapter 2 verse 3, that in him is a treasure of wisdom and knowledge. And also 1 Corinthians 1 verse 30, the Bible says that God has made him unto us righteousness, sanctification, redemption, and wisdom. Jesus is our wisdom. He is the power of God and he is the wisdom of God. Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. So Jesus is wisdom. Jesus is wisdom. Now, the Queen of Sheba came with hard questions. She came with hard questions to the Lord. She tried to inspect him, to investigate him, to analyze him. But all her questions were answered adequately, fully. And you know what? I look at the Bible and I look at Jesus. At one point, just before he was crucified, in fact, 3 days to his crucifixion, 3 days to his crucifixion, they brought questions to Jesus. 3 questions. He had just cleaned the temple. He cleaned the temple twice. At the beginning of his ministry and at the end of his ministry. The last week when he's being crucified, he cleaned the temple. Now, this last time, after cleaning the temple, he was confronted by the authorities. And they questioned Jesus. Asked 3 questions. The first question was about his authority. Where do you get this authority? Where did the authority of John the Baptist come from? Did it come from heaven or from the earth? We know how he answered. They said they couldn't answer when he asked where the authority of John came from. And Jesus too said, neither will I answer you where I get my authority from. So the first question, all these 3 questions, they are in Luke chapter 20. So the first question was, where have you gotten your authority from? He defeated that question because he asked them a question they couldn't answer. The second question was not on authority. The second question was on integrity. Should we pay taxes to Caesar or not? Give me a coin. Whose image is this? Caesar. Give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar and give to God what belongs to God. He defeated the question of integrity. The third question was a question of theology. The Sadducees, they didn't believe in resurrection. So they said to Jesus, a brother had a wife, then his brother took that wife when he died, the third one, the fourth one, the fifth one, up to the seventh one. So finally the woman died and all the brothers are dead. When they go to heaven, whose wife will she be? Is it the firstborn, the first brother, the second or the seventh? And Jesus said, in heaven, they are like angels, they don't marry, they are not given marriage. And the Bible says, when you go to verse 39 and verse 40, that he answered every question correctly. After that, they dare not ask him another question. In other words, just like Solomon, when Solomon was questioned, he answered every question perfectly. Can I hear an amen? Jesus is the wisdom. He is the wisdom. There is no question, there is no problem he cannot solve that he cannot answer. Number 2, Solomon was a great king. Solomon was a great king. You know, he was a king over the all nations. He used to speak to the nations. But Jesus is the King of Kings and is the Lord of Lords. He doesn't just speak to the nations, he speaks to all creation. That is Jesus. Number 3, Solomon answered every question. He answered every question that was brought to him. Just like we had said earlier. But you know what? Solomon answered the questions of the Queen of Sheba, but Jesus is the answer. Whatever question you may be having today in life, whatever dilemma, whatever is strange in you, you can consult with the Lord. In Jeremiah 33 and verse 3, Jeremiah 33 verse 3, the Bible says, call unto me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things which you do not know. Call unto Jesus. What questions do you have in life? Jeremiah 33 verse 3. Call unto me and I will answer you. That's what the Lord is saying. I will answer you and show you great and mighty things. He's able to answer you even beyond what you ask. Even beyond what you think. Ephesians 3 verse 20. God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we ask or even imagine. Are you having questions in life? Are you imagining of what you can become, of what you can do, of places you can reach? Whether it's asking or it's imagination, God is able to do exceedingly abundantly even above all. So he will not just give you the way. You know, at times we want God to open a door. We want God to open a door. The Queen of Sheba came to Solomon. She had questions. And maybe today, the question you have is, God, can you make a way for me? Is God, can you open a door for me? Let me tell you, Jesus is greater than Solomon. Solomon gives answers. Solomon gives ways or opens doors. But Jesus is saying, I am the way. He's not just opening, giving you a way. He's saying, he's not just opening a door for you. He's saying, I am the door. The moment you have Christ in your life or in your heart, doors open for you. There is a way made for you. Can I hear an amen? Praise the Lord. You know, today, I can have a little, you know, a young baby, an infant. You can have a child of 1 year old child. And assume that 1 year old child, she wants to go buy smoking down there. I mean, I can choose to explain the way to that child. You will go down, you will go out, turn left, then take stairs, take the other stairs, and then get out of the main door and turn left. You will find somebody selling smoky there and you'll get a smoke. I can explain to a child the way. But you know what? I can also choose, if that baby is crying for a sausage or smoky, I can choose to pick that child, put that child on my back, carry him to the smoky person and buy that child that sausage. Now, if I do that, I'm not giving the way. I become the way to that baby. When I put that baby on my back, I become the way to that baby. And we as children of God, God is not giving us direction. God is not showing us the way. He's taking us on the back. He's putting us on his shoulder. And he's taking us to our destiny and to our blessing. Can I hear an amen? Amen. So number four, the Queen of Sheba saw the temple. The temple that had been built by Solomon. All that is where we read. 2 Chronicles chapter 4, verse 1 to 4. She saw the temple, the house of God that Solomon had built. And she was amazed. And she was touched. How magnificent it was. But the good news is that Jesus is greater than Solomon. Why? Jesus said to Peter, there in Matthew chapter 16, Matthew 16, verse 13 to 18 there. Matthew 16, verse 13 to 18. Who do men say I am? And Peter, they say, some say you are Elijah. Some say you are Jeremiah. Some say you are one of the prophets. And then he turns to the disciples. And I always love that verse. I always love that scripture. He turned to the disciples and said to them, it doesn't matter what people say I am. No, those who are far away, it doesn't matter what they think about me. Those who are away, it doesn't count what they say about me. But you, we sleep the same place, we walk together, you are my relatives, you are my close people. Who do you say I am? No, who do you say I am? You have the privilege of seeing my nakedness, of seeing my weaknesses, of seeing my problems and challenges in life. Who do you say that I am? Your testimony is more important than the testimonies of those who are far away. And Peter stood and said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus looked at Peter and said, Simon, Simon, flesh and blood has not revealed this unto you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I said to you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. I will build the temple. On this rock, I will build the house of God. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Amen. Jesus is saying that on the rock of the revelation that Jesus is the Messiah. The revelation that Jesus is the Christ. The moment you have that revelation that Jesus is not just a religious leader. Hallelujah. When you get that revelation that Jesus is the Christ, he's building the church. Not a physical building. Not a temple like the Old Testament. He's building the church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Can I hear an amen? Solomon built a glorious, magnificent temple. But you are the temple of God today. Build on the foundation of Christ himself. You are the temple of the Lord today. And can I tell you something about you as the temple of God? Something about you as the temple of God? Haggai chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. Haggai chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. Bible says, the Lord, the silver is mine. The gold is mine. Thus says the Lord. And on this temple, I will fill with the glory. The glory of the latter house shall be greater than the glory of the former. The temple of Solomon was glorious. It was full of glory. But I'm here to announce to you, as the temple of God in this latter house, because you are the temple in this generation, you shall be even of greater glory and more glory. And how is God going to make you glorious? Not just with the heavenly things, but even with the silver and the gold. The Lord is going to bless you so much. No people in this world respect silver and gold. But God is saying, in whatever you level you are, God will make you even more glorious. Amen. In the latter house. Solomon built the temple, but Jesus is building the church. He's the one who is working in you, both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Number five, the table, the meat at the table, the meat at the table. Bible says that Queen of Sheba, when she appeared at the palace where Solomon was, and she saw how the meat, the food was arranged, how the food was served, then she was moved, she was amazed, she melted when she saw the food that was served at the table. Now look at Jesus, the greater than Solomon. He has given us food, food of the word of God. And at times I look at the Bible, the way the Bible is arranged, the way the Bible is put, and I'm amazed. No, if today I was to write the Bible, it was the one doing God's book, I would put it in a, you know, I'll put it in a certain system. I would divide it in a way that maybe the first book, I'm talking about finances. Then the next book, I'm talking about family. Then the next book, I'm talking about parenting. Then the next book, I'm talking about ministry. Then the next book, I'm talking about friendship or relationship. I mean, I would arrange the Bible like that. But the Bible is not written like that. So that if you take the Bible, you can take a chapter. And even from one chapter or from one book, you will find something to do with finances, something to do with family, something to do with relationship. So that today, if I take the Bible to read, whatever chapters I'm reading, I am able to grasp some wisdom on where I am. I don't have to wait for after 3 months or 4 months to learn about a subject. But everywhere throughout the Bible, each and every subject is released or is touched or is educated. I mean, the point is, I want to encourage us that this is meat and this is food. And let us give it priority. I don't know how much we read the Bible or how much we meditate and we memorize and we speak and share about the Bible. Listen to Job. Job, in the midst of suffering and temptations, this is what he said in Job 23 verse 12. Job 23 verse 12. He said, I have esteemed your word more than my necessary food. I have valued. Job is saying,
He's going through temptations and challenges and difficulties. But then he's saying, I have valued in the midst of all my challenges. I have esteemed your word. I have treasured your word. I have valued your word more than my necessary food. Normally, I put it this way. If you gave Job breakfast and the Bible, he would take first the Bible, then take breakfast. If you gave Job lunch and the book of Luke, he would first take the book of Luke and then out eat lunch. If you give him in the evening dinner and the book of Daniel, he would first take the book of Daniel and then take dinner. That is how much he valued and esteemed the word of God. Question for you. How much of your time are you giving to the Bible? Jesus is greater than Solomon. That's what he said. And he's serving us with food. He's serving us with food of his word. The Bible is available. The Bible is available for you. You can take a chapter a day. Or you can take 2 chapters a day. You can take a memory verse and decide this week, I'm memorizing this one verse. Now, I may not know many, many Bible verses, but I'm taking this one verse and I'm putting it into memory. I will allow the word of God to guide me and to lead me. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. And I challenge you as church, read the Bible, read it systematically, read it consistently. You may not read the Bible the way I read. I'm full time, all the day. I'm in the church every other time. So you may not read like me. But you can read the Bible in 1 year. I mean, one apocrypha. Praise the Lord. Or even in 3 years. You can even do it. But be systematic. Amen. And be consistent. Hallelujah. Be systematic and be consistent. For me, by the way, the corona did good for me. Because the day corona came, from March, I started reading the Bible, the whole Bible, every month. March I did it, April I did it, May I did it, June I did it. I decided now that there is restrictions of he cannot visit me, Pastor Steve. Amen. We don't have a lot of time with him. I have all the time with the Bible. So I decided every month I'm reading the whole Bible. And I've been doing it every month. May, March, April, May. Because I put priority to the word of God. Number 6. He looked at the servants. Number 6. He looked at the servants. Bible says he looked at how servants were sitting and how they were serving. There in 2 Chronicles chapter 9, verse 1 to 4, our reading. He looked at the way they were dressed, the clothing of the servants. And she melted. And she was amazed. But when he talks of the clothing, he was looking at how beautiful they were arrayed, how beautiful their apparels were. And we too, Jesus, the greater than Solomon, Jesus, the greater than Solomon, we his servants, we are not naked anymore. We used to, but we are not naked anymore. Isaiah 61 verse 10, the Bible says, he has clothed us with the robe of righteousness. If you are a Christian today, if you are a believer today, I want you to know, when God looks at you, he doesn't see a sinner. He doesn't see a failure. He doesn't see what you did last week or 5 months ago. The devil is the accuser of brethren. The devil may accuse you day and night about something you did or something you didn't do. But Isaiah 61 verse 10, God has clothed us with the robe of righteousness. 2 Corinthians 5:21, the Bible says, he who knew no sin was made sin for us. Amen. That we might become the righteousness of God. When today God looks at you, he doesn't see you as a sinner. He sees you the righteousness of God. Not because of what you are doing, not because of what you are not doing, but because you are clothed with the righteousness of Jesus Christ. That is good news. Can you say amen? That is good news. We are servants of God. And when we are walking around, we are going to amaze the Queen Shepherds of today. Because we understand it's not about me. It's about the greater than Solomon, who is working in us and who is feeding us and the one who is using us. Number seven, finally. The Queen of Sheba looked at the way the servant and Solomon were ascending at the altar. The way they were going up to the house of God. The way they were going to the altar. She looked at that, and the Bible says she melted. No spirit was left in her. And the greater than Solomon, Jesus, he has ascended. Where did he go? This is the words of Jesus in John 14 verse 1 and 2. John 14 verse 1 and 2. Let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. I ascend. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare this place, I will come back. So that where you are, where I am, there you may be also. Jesus has ascended to heaven. The Queen of Sheba saw how Solomon was going at the altar to the house of God. But we too, we are looking at the greater than Solomon, Jesus himself. He has ascended to heaven. What does that mean? It means that because he ascended and now sits at the right hand of the Father, he has now descended. He has now released the Holy Spirit who is with us and who is in us. The Holy Spirit, he has come again and now dwells in us in the person of the Holy Spirit. That is the beauty of understanding that Jesus is not in the grave, he has ascended. He said to his disciples, it is to your advantage that I go. Because if I don't go, I will not send the Holy Spirit. But if I go, I'm going to distribute to all believers the Holy Spirit. So what I'm saying is that we are not alone. You may be, you know, you are not, people may forsake your things. You may quit, you know, you may lose a job or you may lose something, but you are not alone. We have the Holy Spirit who is there with us to help us carry on the work that Jesus started. So points that we are learning today, Jesus is greater than Solomon. Solomon had wisdom. Jesus is the wisdom. He was a great king. But Jesus is the King of Kings. Solomon gave answers. Jesus is the answer. He is the way. He is the door. Solomon built the temple. Jesus is building even a greater temple. He was providing meals and meat to his servants. We are being provided with the Word of God. Take your prescription every day. God has provided a dose for you every day. For you to be healthy, for you to be wealthier, and for you to do well. May the Lord bless us. As we continue, let's give the Lord a clap.